Good evening. As I told those of you who are watching before the news, tonight we're talking about the Second World War, and particularly, why is there still this obsession with the way that we blew each other's brains out 27 years ago? A bit longer, actually, 32 to 27 years ago. Russell Braddon, the author who had some experience of war in the Far East, was just telling me whether or not everybody in the forces, or a large number of people, thought the thing was worth fighting. Russell, I'm sorry I interrupted you. Go on.
Right.
Russell Braddon next to Rosie Boycott.
You're claiming that there is an obsession now as there never has been. The obsession now is nothing compared with the obsession that existed in the 50s when a book about the war would sell 100,000. You try writing one today and you're lucky if you sell 10.
I'd better declare a vested interest. I'm doing precisely that at the moment.
Sure. And if you make a film about the war, you were certain of success in the 50s. Today it's got to have a special something, usually people being blown higher into the air than they ever were in the old films, to get the audience along, and the audience are kids.
Isn't it better to have, is it not better to have a film about the war, which I think most of us agree is not very likely, this major war, than to have war about policemen who do actually exist thumping people, to have war about terrorists killing people, which could, there could be a following example. I know that about twice a month I have a recurrent dream. I'm in an aeroplane with a helmet on and somebody says it's time to drop, Tomlin, and I go out and the tracers go round me and I somehow land, and then I'm being carried out of a prisoner of war camp in a wooden horse, and then I'm crouching in a ditch while those German motorcyclists come past, and then finally, just before I wake, I'm in a fishing boat, you know, coming in. I don't think that does me any harm at all, because that was my war. I was 8 years old, and my war was John Mills' movies.
But it doesn't tell me why a lot of people, despite Russell Braddon, are interested in the Second World War. There's a young gentleman behind on the second row there who's had his hand up for some time. What do you want to say,
sir? I'd just like to say that I think today the children are being brought up listening all about war, right? And I think this is what partly is causing the prejudice against foreigners, you know. I think this is what
you still think youngsters hate the Germans because of what they see in comics and things
no,
like that.
No, but I mean, can I just bring a typical example?
Yes.
Right, the whites and the blacks.
Yeah.
They're fighting, right? The young kids today, you see them. They hate the blacks, you know, especially the area that I come from.
Uh-huh.
Right, in Brixton.
Where is that? That's Brixton.
Brixton, yes. Oh, I come from Brixton. I know, but they hate the blacks, and they're fighting with
the
blacks.
I mean everybody, because clearly there's a youngster here on the front row who
I'm not
who
saying everybody. I'm saying...
Well, let him reply, because I think that was a fairly incautious generalisation.
And the school I'm in, about a quarter of them are coloured, you know, yet we get on with them, you know, and this is it. But I live near Brixton.
Has this got to do with an apparent obsession, at least with a literary form of violence or a literary depiction of a very big violent thing that happened 25, nearly 30 years ago? Jimmy Perry.
I find, and it's a one very sad aspect of this, that there's a lot of men who spent all their lives living in suburbia, and the one little niche in their life is when they were in the services. Now, they loathed it at the time, but they all live in retrospect. They talk about nothing else but that little bit of their life.
That because it was possibly the most exciting
because
bit of their
life? Because they didn't like it at the time, and we didn't like it. Anybody liked it. They loathed
it. This doesn't explain youthful obsession.
But I'll tell you, when we first started on Dad's Arm, we were writing this show for the over 40s. It's all the kids that love it. Why, I don't understand. But my kid's 15, he's obsessed with war. I don't encourage him in any way. But I think we should make clear a definition between war and the last war. We're talking about the Second World War.
We are talking about the Second World War
against
Hitler.
We're not discussing any other war.
No.
That's a thing. And the Second World War was an entirely different kettle of fish.
I think for those who were in the Second World War and who actually thought about it, there was this crusade, is I suppose a very glamorous word, but there was the feeling that this one had to be fought. And as Nick Tomlin said right at the beginning, maybe it was the most worthwhile war that has been fought, at least for some time.
In that. I mean, didn't the English think the war against Bonaparte
British,
was a great...
Yeah.
The British, my apologies. Everyone in every war thinks their war was special. This is the point I'm making. It's part of our lives.
All right, most of the chaps who've spoken here actually went out and did some of the fighting, but you, Mrs. Irwin, sat back at home and were on the receiving end. Now, did you think it was worthwhile going through?
No, I don't think it was worth going through.
Why not?
Because it was an upheaval, wasn't it?
Yeah, I know, but so is having a baby.
Yes, but they say no.
You get a birth value.
That's the difference. You get something for it. This, no, we went into that war, didn't we? And I can honestly tell you it was a relief when I heard planes overhead. Because for the first early part of that war, we were in a right mess.
I'm not sure that you convinced me it wasn't worth going through. What I would like to know is...
Well, it was said that it was a war to finish all...
Oh, no, no.
..trouble, wasn't it?
This one, I think... Well, I think we've all agreed on the front row, even those who are violently against selling that war, that it really did... We really did think it had
yes,
a purpose.
My husband
and a
went
very
through,
specific and necessary purpose.
My husband went through the First World War. And
yeah,
I wouldn't like to tell
selling,
you his opinion.
We're not selling the
no,
First World
I knew
War
you're
in the
not,
same way.
But he told them, when this war was over, he'd only died in 1950, and when this war was over, he said this one should be remembered. He's
well,
got
it should
books.
Be, but
I'm
just wondering why we're remembering so much. Can I talk to Guthrie Moyer on the third row there? Guthrie, you were a prisoner in the Far East, and therefore I don't suppose your war was the jolly war that various other chaps had, and maybe not half as exciting as the suburban people Jimmy Perry was referring to. Was it all worthwhile? And if it was, or was not, can you throw any light on why people should be so fascinated with that war at this moment?
Well, my experience was similar, of course, to Russell Braddon's. It was a fairly dreary experience, but I think it was worth going through. Going back to Leonard Cheshire's first point, I think that if the... On the whole issue of the war industry, I think if the war industry had been more the production of books and so on about the First World War, and the publicity about it afterwards had been more effective at the time of Hitler's rise, we mightn't have had the Second World War. And that's why I think it's quite valuable that this sort of constant pumping of propaganda and the facts and rubbing it in should go on. The only thing that absolutely... I mean, I go on writing about it myself. The only thing that maddens me is when people write about it inaccurately. A film like The Bridge on the River Kwai drove me mad for various reasons, which it would take me too long to explain
yeah, don't,
now.
Guthrie, you work in television, you know. But does writing about a war, to the extent that there has been, does it actually repel people from war, or does it attract them to the idea?
I should think if it's accurate writing, it must repel them. Accurate programmes, too.
All right, Russell Braddon down on the front row.
A little of the reality. Any of us today, if we see something nasty happening, hesitate to interfere. Then you read books or you meet people like Group Captain Cheshire, whom you insist upon calling Mr. Cheshire, with his Victoria Cross and everything else, and you realise that there is a man who 100 times... flew over Europe and each time intervened in something that was terrifying, and he's not a bloodthirsty brute. Each time he made himself do it, there is something to be said about mankind and the spirit of mankind and what it can achieve if it must. And that is...
Does it have to be said through war? Does it have to be experienced through war?
Unfortunately,
that... Surely what Group Captain Cheshire yes. is doing now is maybe in his own head, and we'd better ask him,
indeed,
more valuable than what he did then.
Yes, and did the one arise from the other?
Go on, then.
Well, I can't tell that it's more valuable. Each man's got to do his own job in their own situation. I know that in that war, there was a feeling of urgency, a sense of urgency I've hardly ever felt in the rest of my life. I knew there was nothing for it. I loathed war. And ever since then, I've had it in my mind, perhaps unjustly, for those who got us into that position. I don't know why it is that the young are so interested in war. I wish I did know. I hope the programme will tell us. I think there is one reason why some of the people of my generation are interested, because I, at the moment, am trying to collect people's reminiscences written at the time so that we can get into their minds. And I find a lot of people, the ordinary bod, as I'd call him, whether officer or in other rank, he's got his experiences that he went through in those 6 years, and nobody has ever wanted to ask him about them. His children not wanted to know. Like, I wouldn't hear from my father. I wouldn't let my father talk about the war. And for the first time, suddenly said, I want to know. And it's come out like a flood. It's been locked up in his heart all the time. And I have a feeling that this has been one that, as you said, one little experience in his life that's been different from all the others. And he just wants to relive it or get it out.
Can I speak to Jonathan Greenclair? just behind you, because he has been...
Now, with all due respect to everybody who took part in the war, who know more about that than I do, I'm a bit worried about this obsession that people have here with youth being interested to such a great extent with war. I don't think they are. I think no more, let us say, than they were in the 20s, when one could read good war books, than they probably were, and I don't know the details, in the 19th century and so on. War is a perennially interesting topic, exciting, especially if it's vicarious excitement.
No, surely, there are two points here, Jonathan. First of all, from personal experience, one knows that the Mail, a programme, a documentary about the war, that war, produces, a good proportion comes from youth.
Yes, but that doesn't make youth particularly obsessed with it, that everybody seems so intent upon proving here.
No, but the second thing is that Leslie Scott has said that in that generation that fought through it, there's declining interest. They're no longer interested in talking about it.
I would have hoped the decline started much after the time they were demobbed.
There's a gentleman at the end of that row where Jonathan Green is who hasn't spoken yet.
Yes. Well, first of all, I'd like to agree with our friend. I personally don't think that the youth today are obsessed with war. I don't really think they're all that interested in it. Some of our friends here have said that those who lived through the war don't want to forget it. Now, I'm not suggesting for 1 minute they do forget it, because with or without the things that we have today, the obsession, if you like, they're not going to forget it either way. But I think that all these war films, and it's overplayed, obviously I think someone is making a vast fortune out of all this. I think this is all
well,
it
Well, they are. That's, I mean, one of the reasons for this programme is that they are, and I wonder why. Do the youngsters here, who have no recollection of it at all, for obvious reasons concerned with Anno Domini, I mean, do you think that you've been told the truth about the war, the old remark that the first casualty of war is truth? Have you been told the truth about the war? Do you want to know the truth?
Well, I don't think we've been told all the truth. You know, they must have, I think, you know, the Germans, the Nazis killed millions of people in concentration camps. Yet I think it's, you know, not on the larger scale, but, you know, British troops of people may have killed, you know, a few people, you know.
But they certainly did, yeah.
And yet the press, you know, the press keeps this out, you know. I'm completely against the war, but, you know, I think the press only tell you what they want you to tell.
I think a lot of people who fought in it were against it at the time, particularly when it was nasty. What about you there at the back?
Well, mate, when I want to learn about the war, I like to watch it on a purely documentary basis.
Mm. And are you getting truth, do you think? I mean, are you still getting a one-sided
version?
Do you still
yes, but
have a feeling that Germans are rather nasty?
No, not at all.
You don't?
No.
Jimmy, you've been saying.
Well, I think there's a clear difference here. I've seen war films. I'm not particularly interested in war films. There's always psychopaths in them. Now, I was in the army with thousands of men. I never met a psychopathic killer. I just met dreary, boring blokes like myself, bank clerks, grocers, assistants, factory, and we were bored. We were dull. And that was it. And I think anybody that doubts the last war and doubts why it was fought should read Pierre Lavelle's biography about the fall of Vichy France and what went on there for 4 years. I'm sorry to say this, we're going in the common market, but it's well worth reading, and then you'll wonder just whether we did do such
yes,
a bad job.
Well, there's a point here. You see, you use the word boring, and who's that man who said the war is 90% boredom and 10% excitement? Well, if it's all that boring, why is it so exciting and interesting?
Because all we're giving people is the 10%, for heaven's sake.
Yes. Some of the boring bits out.
Yeah, that's
all we're saying. I'm a bit fed up with all this hoo-ha about all the money made out of war films.
Well, it's well be that.
The other thing that films make and books make money out of is sex. Do you want that stopped too?
Yes. It just makes
I prefer sex to war, I must say.
Yes. Yeah, but what is the disagreement? You don't like people making money?
No, there's no disagreement. I'm trying to find out, and I'm not succeeding, why there is this obsession with it, enough to enable people to make money. Mrs. Cohen, on the third row, can you get
to that? This young gentleman at the end here pointed out exactly what I was trying to say before. They are interested in learning about the war. They don't want to see the glamorised love stories in the middle of a war. They're interested in the documentary films. And I don't see any harm in this, because from this, they will learn that it is no good to have a war, and maybe they will grow up to be the sort of people who can run this country or run the world without declaring wars on each other.
I'm not so sure that everybody here would accept it's no good to have a war. I think a proposition that you might like to discuss is that a war may settle a particular problem. The last one settled the problem
still,
of Nazism,
still not a good
although it may
thing
create
to
others.
It's still not a good thing to have.
It may be better than the alternative.
Yes, that is true.
Do you want to speak, Mr. Cheshire?
I'm very interested in this fact that it is stated in the programme that the youth are very interested, I don't like the word obsession, but very interested in war. This is a great surprise to me. I wasn't aware of that, and it's contrary to what I should have imagined. Is that the truth that's established, is it?
It is certainly the truth from my own experience. It is a truth derived from people who study the sales of the various war magazines, the publications.
It's also an acknowledged journalistic truth. We may be fooling ourselves, but any war, I know we're talking about the Second World War, but every time there is a war, everybody turns to their newspapers, they buy more. They're buying more at the moment because of Uganda. They bought more during the Indo-Pakistan War. They do respond to that sort of violence, and that seems to be an objective fact.
I'm going to say good night to you while this discussion goes on. I thought,
can we not see this in context? It's just a new temporary fashion. It used to be cowboys and Indians, cops and robbers. Conflict is the essence of entertainment, and this is really all it boils down to. This fashion will die, and there'll be another one. You know, I can't think why we're making quite so much fuss about choosing this particular subject. I have books about it.
Well, there's an awful lot going on this week about it.
I think there's more to it. I think that youth is deeply concerned about peace in the world, deeply concerned about the injustices in the world. And this is one of the new facets of our present-day life. We weren't when I was a child.